that horn says hello and welcome, welcome and welcome. Question to you. Where are you linking us from? I want you to put it in the chat. Put it in the chat. Type it in the chat. Where you are linking us from. Thank you. Is this your first time? Please put your email in the chat. We would like to send you a soft copy of this booklet. A soft copy. My Health and the Creator. There are 8 of them. Thank you. The Healing of the Nations presents weekly services. Wednesdays at 7 p.m. we have Healing, Health and Restoration Prayer Service. Tuesdays at 6:30 a.m. Let's Pray. Saturdays 5:30 a.m. to 9 a.m. we have Early Morning Health. At 9 a.m. to 10 a.m. we have Church at Study. At 10 a.m. we have Saturday Service. Today's at 5 p.m. we have Extending Your Life Naturally. And on Sundays at 5:30 p.m. we have Bible Study. For contact information, you can call us at 646-400-5720. That's 646-400-5720. And if you wish to email us, hon.ministry@gmail.com. Thank you.
We're thrilled to announce part 2 of the highly anticipated Curing the Incurables virtual course. If you're passionate about creating herbal formulas and tinctures to overcome incurable diseases, look no further. In just 8 days, we will provide you with the knowledge and tools to do just that. Gain advanced strategies and insights to conquer seemingly incurable diseases. Join us for the Curing the Incurables Part 2 virtual course, hosted by Daley Health and Eden's Nutritious Treats, from November 5th to November 12th, 2023. Dive into the material from 6 p.m. to 9 p.m. nightly. Don't miss this exclusive opportunity. Secure your spot by clicking the link below before registration closes. Our esteemed presenter, Mammon Wilson, has over 40 years of experience in medical missionary work. He has captivated audiences worldwide with his health talks and training. As a gospel medical missionary, he leads the renowned Centurion Bible School of Health, along with a prominent lifestyle center. Mammon Wilson's groundbreaking natural cancer regimens have earned him a stellar reputation for assisting those facing terminal illnesses. Experience the same intensive training that medical missionaries paid thousands of dollars for, but at a fraction of the cost and from the comfort of your own home. At the Curing the Incurables Part 2 virtual course, you'll learn how to formulate herbal mixtures, tinctures, poultices, and ointments, techniques to reverse uncontrollable blood pressure, methods to heal diabetic sores, strategies to stop bleeding that leads to death, complete training in hydrotherapy treatments, captivating live demonstrations of natural remedies, bonus insights on setting up your own wellness home center and ministry. So, what are you waiting for? Register now to secure your spot by clicking the link below. Invite your friends and family to join you on this life-changing journey. We look forward to meeting you there.
Good night, everyone. Good night, and welcome again to Wednesday service. My name is Courtney Linton, and I must say a special welcome to Sister Jennifer, Sister Marie, Pastor Daley, welcome. Favorite, welcome. Healing Aliens, welcome. Hi, welcome, Sister Joan, welcome, Sister Nicole, welcome, Sister Peggy, welcome, Sister Sharon, welcome, Sister P, welcome, Sister Veronica, welcome, and 1609, I know that is Sister Yvonne, and so welcome to Wednesday service. If you have not invited someone, please do so. Know what we have on the screen. If you have not signed up or registered, please register now. Click on the link. My tech team will put the link in the chat. Click on it and register. I mentioned in our group this morning, sharing with you that this is an investment in your health. I don't think you heard me. It's an investment in your health. It's $199. That's less than a dollar a day, right? It is less than a dollar a day. And so invest in your health. Welcome again to Hon Ministry. And Pastor, would you like to add anything to this, this poster, any
well, thank you, Courtney, and thank you, Courtney. Good evening, everyone. It's nice to have you on. And as Courtney said, this is an end time training. You're going to learn how to make formulas for various diseases. If somebody has cancer, you will learn how to make herbal formulas, diabetes, high blood pressure. A lot of people are trying to keep away from the medications, but you can't just keep away from them. You have to have alternative. Neither are we saying you should not take your medications. And also this is for a time when we will not be able to buy ourselves, which means you won't be able to go to the hospitals unless you have the mark of the beast. You won't be able to go to the pharmacy except you have the mark of the beast. But what will you do? You have to learn to survive from now by learning to utilize all the herbs that God has given us and all the other things to make the proper formula. Even right now, there are a number of people in your churches who are sick, and your workplace who are sick, in your neighborhood. This can also be a means of you pointing them to Christ, the great healer of body, mind, and spirit. So, as Courtney said, this is an investment in your health, curing the incurable. Elder Wilson, if things go as planned, we're going to be here on the Sunday and the Sabbath afternoon. That is November 4 and November 5th, right here in Brooklyn. So pray for this. And I realize that more people are signing up now as we reach the deadline of October 5th. Congratulations. God bless you real good.
Thank you, Pastor. You know, if we had more time, I would have asked you to share these testimonies where, like the day before, when we had medical missionary training in the past, like the day before, that's when people got the money to pay for it. Because Sister Favored is asking me to pay for it, Pastor. So I wanted her to share, you to share.
All right. Perhaps Courtney, let me do that, Courtney. Now, if you believe God wants you to go to this seminar, beloved, it's only $199. And if you pray, God will open the doors. Here's what I normally tell people. Tell five people that this Curing Incurable virtual seminar is coming up, and I'm financially challenged. How much can you give me? If you speak to five people, I know that God is going to open the door for you. But you have to believe. You have to believe. If God was able to feed 2 million Israelites 40 days with no Walmart, no key food, or no supermarket, no farm, He's able to take care of you with one $499 for 8 days. That's amazing. So just have faith. Step out in faith. Don't say, I don't have the money. If you say you don't have the money, you shut your mind, shut down, and you don't think. Your creative powers don't come to be. None that's in anything. Say, God is going to provide. And he has already provided, but you have to step out in faith. All right?
Amen. Thank you for sharing that, Pastor. Now I'm going to ask Sister Marie to pray, opening prayer. Go ahead, my sister.
Okay, good evening, everyone. Pleasant Wednesday to you all. Let us pray. Our Father, which art in heaven, we want to give you thanks and praise, Father God, for allowing us to make it through another day. We're here this evening on the Wednesday night service on Healing of the Nation. And we're few in numbers, but your Holy Spirit is here with us. So, Father God, we're asking for your holy guidance as we go through this service. May the information that's shared be well received by your people, and may they be blessed and share it with others as they go about their days. Bless us as we continue throughout this week. Guide and protect us each and every day. And may your name be praised, honored, and glorified in everything that we do. This is my prayer. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Sister Marie. Now, we have a special song, a very special song that I will be playing. And let me put it up on the screen here.
I thought that you would be singing, Courtney. That's why I was here waiting to hear.
Pastor, we are going to live long because we love to laugh, Pastor, and laughing is good, and that's just a short health nugget there.
In my moments of fear, through every pain, every tear, there's a God who's been faithful to me. When my strength was all gone, and when my heart had no song, still in love, he's proved faithful to me. Every word he promised is true. See, what I thought was impossible, I've seen my God do. Faithful, faithful to me. Looking back, his love and mercy I see. Though in my heart I have questioned and failed to believe, faithful to me. When my heart looked away, the many times I could not pray, still my God, he was faithful.
Amen, amen. Over to you, Pastor.
All right. Thank you very much, Courtney. And we just want to, again, say welcome to everyone. Father, in the name of Jesus, we pray that you will let your love shine through us right now. I pray, Lord, that you will open our spiritual understanding. Let your spirit be the teacher. Let your spirit be the teacher right now. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen and amen. Are you seeing my presentation, Courtney?
No, Pastor.
Oh, I see. I know why I didn't bring it up. Sorry.
Didn't share, yes.
Mm-hmm. It's coming up, folks. Don't worry. Now, for the whole month of September, we have been talking about two things. Lord, increase my faith. And then we have spoken about the health. So it's a faith, it's a spiritual and physical healing program we've been doing since September. I'm doing the spiritual part, and Monet in lifestyle is doing the physical part. So thus far, I have spoke about Lord, increase my faith, part 1, 2, and 3. And are we taping? Yeah, not streaming. And Eden Lifestyle has presented battling and beating diabetes and easing the pressure naturally. And last week we spoke about the answer to cancer. Now we're doing this because for you to get the physical healing and benefit, faith is a very important factor. So this evening, I'm going to talk about Lord, increase my faith, part 4. And Eden Lifestyle, I'm going to talk about natural remedies for common diseases. So we want you to really share this with somebody. So Courtney, if anybody who missed any of the previous section, how can they get it? Brother Courtney?
We have a group, Han guest group, and that's where we put the YouTube. It's a private YouTube, and that's where we put the link. And so if you want to be a part of that group and you get all of the programs that are coming up, and you get extra too. And also we are walking to Texas. If you want to figure out, oh, we are walking to Texas, then you come up, be a part of the group. Over back to you, Pastor.
All right, thank you. So how do they be a part? You're going to drop it in the chat, right?
Yes, my tech support will drop it in the chat.
And folks, you can share these presentations. Just don't keep them for yourself. Encourage others to be a part of the group, so that they can get these presentations, because a lot of people are itching where a lot of people are where these presentations are right now. Blood pressure, diabetes, cancer, natural remedies, and faith. So please do the best you can to share right now. Drop this link and share and ask somebody to come on. Now, if you remember, this was the passage that generated the topic. One day, Jesus was talking to his disciples, as recorded in Luke 17, and Christ was talking to them, saying that offense will come. People are going to offend you, but woe to them that offense come. And then Jesus said, if somebody offend you, and they repent 7 times in one day, you should forgive them. When the disciples said that, they said, oh Lord, increase our faith. It was very difficult for them to conceive of forgiving somebody 7 times in one day. And then the Lord said, if you have faith as a mustard seed, you shall say to this mulberry or sycamore tree, be pulled up by the roots and be planted in the sea, and it will obey you. So although forgiving for 7 times looks so difficult, it may be as deep rooted as a mulberry tree that can probably last over 200 years and have deep roots. The Bible says that if you have a mustard seed faith, all that forgiveness can happen. Most of the time when we think about faith, we think about doing miraculous things. But here the Bible is telling us that we need faith to live in everyday life. As a matter of fact, the Bible says the just shall live by faith. So it's not something that you only use for special moments is something that you use on a daily basis. Now, as we're talking tonight, what do you need an increase in faith to accomplish, to do? I want you to think about that right now. Remember, we learn a number of things as we review. We learn what that faith is, a heartfelt response to God for all that he has done in Christ. That's what the Bible says, by grace are you saved through faith. Our faith is a response to all that God has done, a heartfelt response to all that God has done in Christ. So if you're going to be saved, you need faith. And the Bible says, without faith, it is impossible to please him. You heard that over and over. So those of us who want to please God, it's not how long you go to church, even how long you read the Bible. It's not what degrees you have. It's how you can exercise faith in him. And faith is simply putting your trust and confidence. It's the most simple modern term. It's putting your faith and your trust and confidence in what God has said in his word and in the character of God. So we saw that was part one, where we define faith. Part two, we realize that if you really want to increase your faith, you have to mingle it with hope, because Hebrews 11:1 says, faith is the substance or the guarantee of things hoped for. So if your hope is weak, your faith will be weak. Are you with me, everybody? If your hope is weak, your faith will be weak. And what is hope? Hope is confident expectation. You know, if your hope is going to rain tomorrow, well, you don't know. You hope that you're going to win the lotto, you don't know. But when they said, my hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness, that's confident expectation. When they said, we have this hope that burns within our hearts, hope in the coming of the Lord. You see, that hope is based on the promise, the unfailing promises of God. And the way you develop hope is whatever you're hoping for, you find scriptures and paint a picture, because hope deals with the imagination too. You can't have hope unless you can imagine it. We imagine ourselves in heaven. Imagine yourself being healed. Imagine yourself being healed. Imagine yourself getting the money you need to go to this seminar. Imagine yourself, by God's grace, getting the money you need to send your kids to school. You understand, folks? So that was the second thing. The third thing was that hope must be coupled with patience. Hebrews chapter 12, Hebrews 6, verse 12 and 13 says that through faith and patience, the prophets inherit the promises. Now, if you think about Abraham waited for about 25 years before God brought the child to him. Joseph waited about a number of years before the dream was fulfilled that he would lead his family. David, although he was anointed, he waited about another 13 years before it comes to pass. So you need to have patience. That's why the Bible said in Hebrews 10 verse 35. When you have done the will of God, you have need of patience. Don't quit. You have need of patience, for he that will come and will not tarry. There are so many people give up after they go to a meeting like this, and they hear about faith, and if they start to believe, and they don't see it same time or tomorrow, they give up. No, but that's not faith. That's feeling. Faith has to wait. Faith has to keep on praising God, until you see the results. I'm just summarizing what we went through, folks. So if you did not get these things and you want to increase your faith or to strengthen your faith, because God has already given you the measure of faith according to Romans 12, verse 3. All you need to do now is to utilize the faith that you have, right? And there's another two more concepts I wanted to bring in before going tonight's lesson. We have a very short time, right? Now, the Bible says that faith is the evidence or the proof of things not seen or not perceived by the physical senses. We're told in school that we have five senses, and you know what they are. Those have nothing to do with faith. Faith is the evidence of the proof not seen by the physical senses. What faith deals with, man, is a word of God. Is a word of God. Whatever God says, you can base your faith upon it. So that's what it deals with. Not what you've seen, not what you feel, not what you hear. The Bible says that heaven and earth will pass, but God's word cannot pass. The Bible says that God is not a man that he should lie, nor the son of man that he should change his mind. So you can believe in what God says, whether you see it, feel it, hear it, touch it, or taste it. Are you with me? So faith is the evidence of things not seen, which it implies that we're living in two worlds. We're living in the seen world and the unseen world, the visible world and the invisible world, the natural world and the spiritual world. Faith deals with the invisible world, the natural world, and the spiritual world. Our senses, let me say that again. Faith deals with the invisible world, the spiritual world, and the world that is not seen by the eyes. And then the senses deal with what you see in the natural world. For example, in 2 Kings chapter, I think it was chapter 6 or so, the Syrian army surrounded the prophet Elijah's house. And there were chariots of fire surrounding the house, physically speaking. And then Elijah's servant said, "Alas, my master, look there, look there." When Elijah looked, there were many physical horses around. But then Elijah said to the guy, his servant, "They that are with us are more than they that are against us." What could that be? It's only Elijah and his servant. But Elijah was not talking about things in the physical. Elijah was talking in things in the spiritual. So the Lord said, "Open his eyes, Lord." Like, open his eyes. It was not his physical eyes now. And when the servant's eyes were open, he saw chariots of fire surrounding Elijah's house. That's faith. Faith sees the invisible, my friends. Like right now, everybody here has angels surrounding them. But you don't see them. But the Bible says the angel of the Lord encampeth round about them that fear man deliver them. Do you understand what I'm talking about? So faith deals with what God says, whether I see it or feel it or not. And I'm just wondering today, how many of us here are operating in faith? How many of us here operating in faith? How many of us right now needs to operate in faith? You have some issues that naturally, physically, you don't see how they're going to be solved. But spiritually, they will be solved. Amen? So that's a summary. And the next maybe 7 or so minutes, I'm going to tell you the last aspect of faith that we're going to talk about. It says here, part 4 is faith works by love. I'm going to say that with me, folks. Faith works by love. Now, it took me a long time to understand that because it doesn't make much sense if you just read it on the surface. And that's taken from Galatians 5, verse 6. Maybe some of you have never heard this before. For in Jesus Christ, neither circumcision availeth anything, nor uncircumcision. But what? Faith which worketh by love. You see, Paul was talking to the Galatians, and the Galatians was fighting over whether people should be circumcised or not to be saved. Paul said, these are not the crucial things. Those are insignificant things you're fighting over. What's most important? It's your faith that works by love. Let me read a few more, two more translations, like in the NIV. For in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision has any value. The only thing that counts is faith expressing itself through love. Do you hear that? Faith must work through love. And here's another version, the Amplified version. For if we are in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision mean anything, but only faith activated, are motivated and expressed and working through love. So, beloved, If your faith is going to work as it should, it should be motivated by your love for God and God's love for you, and it should be expressed by God's love for you and your love for God. Are you with me? Are you with me? Now, I don't like these expressions, and I don't try to see how they apply to me. But what does it mean that faith works by love to you tonight? We're talking about increasing our faith. What does it mean that faith works by love? I was trying to conceive of it. And I remember my daughter, when she was a little girl, you know, I used to throw up. I used to put her on my shoulder and ride with her. And she trust daddy, because she know that daddy loves her and daddy is not going to harm her. And in my mind, that's an example of how faith works by love. Now, you know that God loves you, right? So whatever God calls you to do, he calls you to do it in love. And therefore, you can do it. Whatever test or trials you're going through now, because you know that God loves you, what happened? You can bear it. Trust in him and have confidence in him that is going to go. Now, if you know that somebody loves you, will you trust them? Yes, we will trust them. You know they have your back. Isn't that amazing? So faith works through love. So what I do is think about how much God loves you, beloved.
For just a moment, Pastor. Renee, you need to go on to Goshen site. I put the text in the chat. They're waiting for you. Go ahead, Pastor.
Yes. Okay. For when we were yet without strength, listen to now, in due time Christ died for the ungodly. We died for the ungodly. For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God, listen now, demonstrates his love towards us in that while we're yet sinners, our rebels, that word means rebels, Christ died for us. So Christ died for you when you were not lovely or lovable. Imagine that. And if he died for you then, and now you have accepted his love, why don't you think he would treat you in a powerful way? Why don't you think he would treat you in a good way? So we have to be convinced of her. Sometimes you're going through difficulties, you're going through crisis, and you wonder, does God love me? That's a lack of faith. God loves you before you start to serve him and while you're serving him. That's very important. You keep that in mind. God will always love you, beloved. He will always love you. So tonight, you can trust God. You can have confidence in God because he loves you. He died on the cross for you. Will Courtney die for you? Will Pastor Daley die for you? But there's somebody who's far more important than us who died for all of us. He loves you whether you are lovable. He loves the unlovely. He loves you unconditionally. Don't let the devil fool you. You can't do anything to be separated from his love. Look here. Unto him that love us and wash us from our sins in his own blood and has made us kings and priests unto God our Father. Now look at his love. His love has given you a new status. You once were a sinner, but now the Bible says he has made us kings and priests unto God and his Father. Kings were the highest political authority in ancient times, and priests the highest religious authority. So because of the love that God has for you, he washed you from your sins and give you the highest status in life, higher than being a citizen of the United States of America. Man, that should make you jump and shout and wow, that's awesome. That's what God does for you, folks. So I want you to hug yourself and say, thank you, God, for loving me. I want you to hold your hands around your shoulder. Thank you, God, for loving me. I trust you today. I am willing to put my faith in you. I'm willing to surrender to you to do whatever you ask me to do because I know that you love me and I want to express my love for you. All right, last text before we switch over. Listen to what Paul says. In verse 32, which I like, he said, if God did not spare his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him freely give us all things? So because God gave Jesus, he will not withhold anything else from you that will help you to be make you successful in this life and the life to come. What a wonderful God. So he says here, Paul said, I am persuaded, yet in all these things, we're more than conquerors through him that love us. For I am persuaded. Now, he had no doubt that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing, shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. This is a love that will not let you go. When you're not feeling the love of God, it's just you may be operating in feeling, or if you're living in sin, you can't experience the love. It's not that God is pulling away his love from you. It's that you have separated yourself from him. So that's why he will wash you tonight. If you said, Father, wash me, wash me, wash me, cleanse me, renew your spirit, renew the love. It's amazing. How do I get this love? The Bible says that when you receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, one thing that the Holy Spirit does, he pours out that heavenly love in your heart. He pours it out. It's not the love of earthly origin. It's from heaven through the power of the Spirit of God. So this moment, you can say, dear Lord, I have already given myself to Jesus. I ask that the Holy Spirit pour your love in my heart, and I will operate through love. My faith will work through this love that you have. It was this love that lifted me. The song says, I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, very, very deeply staying within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry. From those waters lifted me. Love lifted me. Yes, love lifted me when nothing else could help. Love lifted me. Love lifted me. Oh, yes, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. So tonight, beloved, as we bring this part of the service to the close, I want you now to begin to really think about how God loves you, and you will surrender to him like a child surrenders to a loving father, and your life will begin to work. Your faith will begin to get stronger. You'll see more miracles in your life. You'll see more victories in your life, because God loves you. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we're thankful for your amazing love towards us. And tonight, as we close out this Lord, increase our faith section, we realize that for faith to work, we have to believe that you love us. And when we believe that you love us, we'll trust you and we'll have confidence in what you say. And then life will take on new meaning. In Jesus' name, I pray. And we thank you for hearing your voice, knowing that you'll always love us. Amen and amen. Our tech team will shift right now as we connect with Goshen.
Lord, you know her. She's your child. You created her. You knew her even before her parents thought about her, and you brought her into this world for such a time as this.
When you trust him, so Lord, at this time, we pray that you
might be close to her. And we pray, Lord, that she'll feel your presence.
Recording in progress.
And Heavenly Father,
Brother Courtney, are you there?
As she goes through what she's going through,
all right.
Lord, we just ask for strength for her.
Just meditate on what you heard.
We ask for patience for her. We pray, Lord, for all those who administer her care, all those who check in on her, all those, Lord, who try to ensure that she has an easy time as much as possible. So she was one of the first ones to come on this evening.
I forgot what's happening.
We just want to thank you for her faithfulness. And we look forward to the day, Lord, when she can just throw her hands up She can glorify you. She can praise you. She can adore your holy name because of what you would have done for her. In the meantime, Lord, may she practice praising until that time comes. So once again, bless her, bless her daughter, and bless all those, again, Lord, we've asked before, who surround her, that they'll be positive and that they'll be prayerful and that they'll be persistent in their prayers. So once again, Heavenly Father, you want your children to prosper and to be in health. So we thank you for what you've done, for what you're about to do, what you will continue to do. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. All right, so we have Brother St. Juste with us. And as I said before, he's no stranger. I sort of lost my way there. Yes, he's no stranger to Goshen. He and his wife, Inga, and their beautiful or handsome son, they were with us earlier on in the year. So we welcome you back. We had your brother on last Wednesday. We enjoyed his presentation. Then we had the other brother. So we understand there's three of you and one sister. So we know all the family history now. And we saw, you know, now we are acquainted also with all your beautiful wives and the wonderful work that you're doing on behalf of the king. So continue to work on his behalf. And now I turn you over so that you can have the time that you need so the people will hear you and not me. God bless.
Amen, amen. Good evening, everyone. And I'm praying that everyone hears me properly and that I'm not going in and out. Okay, so today, as we talked about, as we mentioned earlier, I'll be going over some natural remedies for common ailments. And also we'll, you know, leave it open. If you want to ask any questions in the chat, you can feel free to do so. And also probably towards the end, I'll open up for oral questions as well. So you can ask questions with your microphone and so forth. But any questions while I do the therapies and the different natural remedies, you can just feel free to ask those as well. So before we get into this, I just want to invite the Lord to just grant wisdom and help us with our understanding. Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you so much for giving us things in nature. Help us to understand how to use nature correctly, because nature used correctly can be very powerful. And I just pray that as we learn about these natural remedies, that we can learn how to apply them intelligently, that can help to save us, dear Lord, instead of using some of the synthetic medications and pills, that before things get serious, we can even apply these natural remedies to help in our lives, as my friend do the same. Amen. So we just want to go into this here for a little bit, but before we get in, we just want to make sure that we understand what as relates to health and disease. And one of the things that we wanted to look at in terms of health and disease is the four-step process of what you do when you're sick. So then when you look at, well, first of all, disease, as it says in Ministry of Healing, is an effort of nature to free the system from conditions that result from violating or from a violation of the laws of health. So disease come about as we violate those laws of health. Yes.
You were frozen.
Okay, so my internet is going in and out.
Continue now, let me hear.
Okay. All right. Let me see. So I'll just connect my audio on my phone just to make sure that at least my audio stays connected while I'm doing this. Sorry, let me just connect really quick here.
Welcome to Zoom. Enter your meeting ID followed by pound. Enter your participant ID followed by pound. Otherwise, just press. You are in the meeting now. There are more than 20 participants in the meeting. This meeting is being recorded.
All right. Can you hear me better now?
Yeah.
Let me make sure everyone can hear me better. All right, Daley, if my video goes table audio connection here. Okay, so what we want to look at is, we want to go back to the laws of health. Some of us know the Neustadt acronym. We use also God's plan, so like godly trust, open air. So you go back to the laws of health and say, am I getting enough fresh air? Am I getting enough exercise, daily exercise, sunlight, lots of water? Am I drinking water throughout the day? Am I practicing temperance? You know, am I eating the proper nutrition? So we just go back to those 8 laws of health and see where we are lacking. Because, you know, studies have shown that people who go to bed after 10 o'clock each night increase their likelihood of developing diabetes, cholesterol, high blood pressure, and all the various diseases. The same thing for vitamin D. Those who are deficient in vitamin D can develop a slew of diseases like high blood pressure, diabetes, more severe COVID-19, and you know, lack of vitamin D is to a lot of illnesses. Go back to the law of health. If we become sick, what we need to do is to follow the 4-step process where it says in case of sickness, your disease or the cause of your disease should be ascertained. So ascertain means to find out. So we need to find out what is causing my illness, what is causing me to be sick. And after you find out what is causing you to be sick, then you need to change unhealthy conditions. If you're in a work environment that is stressful, that is causing you to have digestive issues like ulcers, because, you know, stress can link to digestive issues. It slows down your digestion, sometimes stops your digestion altogether, and that can cause a whole slew of digestive issues. It can weaken your immune system and so many different things. So you need to change your environment if your environment is causing you to be sick. Some of you might need to get a new job, you know, apply for a new job somewhere that can be less stressful. Also, number 3, you need to correct wrong habits. So if you have habits, like let's say you don't exercise, you're very sedentary, and you don't drink enough water, you just go to the laws of health and see where you're lacking some of those bad habits that you've formed, and you need to correct those wrong habits. And when you have done all those things, you follow the laws of health for your life, you eat a nutritious diet, you go to bed on time, you drink enough water, you exercise daily, you do all these different things, then the 4th step is we can apply nature remedial agencies. And right now you can't see it, but I have some, you know, different stuff that you can use for remedies right here, and you can just apply those nature's remedies. But you want to make sure that you apply the steps before. You want to make sure that you obey the laws of health, because you cannot be applying onion to help kill viruses and so forth, but you can be weakening your immune system by staying up too late every single night. And then you can do all the onion that you want. If you all become, you all sick, and the onion is treated as where you have to keep taking it for the rest of your life. And what we want to do is to reach to a point where these things are used to either service our bodies to prevent it from becoming sick, or when we are sick, then we use it in that moment in our sickness, and then we don't have to use it again. We don't want to be on natural remedies for the rest of our life, just like we're on medications for the rest of our life. And how we can accomplish that is by just obeying the laws of health that can keep disease from coming back and from forming again. And the same thing with cancer. You know, we tell people all the time when they come to our facility and they have cancer, we tell them it's a lifestyle change. It's not just a program where you come to us for like 2 weeks or so forth and you go back home and you just continue living the same old lifestyle that you lived before. No, your lifestyle has to be changed because your body, your immune system is strengthened. You know, you feel more energetic, all these various things of going through a life program. But then when you get home,
You have to make sure that you live the lifestyle that will keep the disease from coming back. And a lot of times people do, like, let's say, breast cancer surgery. They cut off the breast and they cut off, like, that cancer, that tumor mass that is in the breast. But people don't understand that cancer is also in the blood. You know, cancer spreads throughout the different parts of the body. And even though the tumor hasn't formed as yet, or the cluster of cells hasn't gotten big enough to be noticed by any machine, it doesn't mean that cancer is not in our body. That's why most of the times with people who do surgery, the cancer comes back, you know, 5 years later, 7 years later, 8 years later, 9 years later, and it spreads to the spine, it spreads to the bones, it spreads in the lymphatic system. And you just want to make sure that you change your lifestyle habits that can prevent the cancer from growing and coming back while you apply the natural remedies to kill that cancer in its track. And, you know, right now we're in a session. It ends on this coming Sunday, and we've from pancreatic cancer to people have eczema to ulcers and all different types of issues, and we help people to overcome the issues naturally. And, you know, so then what I'm going to show you, Harry, some natural remedies that we use at our lifestyle center, at our facility as well, to help people overcome their different illnesses that they face with. So let us begin here. And one of the things that I probably want to talk about first there, let me just talk about onion really quick here. Onion is right in front of me. I have some other remedies here. Hopefully we can get through all of them here. I also have a cabbage in front of me as well. Cabbage has, you know, many different benefits and uses. I also have some ginger. It's potent as well. Also garlic. You know, garlic, onion, like cousins. And I also have some lemon here. Lemon, this little thing here, can be powerful if you use it in the right way as a medicine. And then I have a good old aloe vera here. Aloe vera is pretty good. If you can get an aloe vera plant, those things just keep bearing more and more and more leaves. And you can never, you know, out use it because it grows faster than you can use it. Even for us there as well, plants, you know, just having an aloe vera plant is a great thing, you know, to have in the house. So let's just start with our onion remedies here. So then some of the things that people deal with, especially during this season here, the season that is coming up, people are going to be getting the flu, the cold, and now added to our list of seasonal flu, cold-like diseases, corona, COVID-19, that will be, you know, coming and spreading around this time every single year as well. And people don't understand this. They think that some of the things will just disappear and go away. The flu, you know, never went away. You have influenza, and it just mutated into other different forms of influenza diseases as the time goes on. So these things will be around. But what we want to do is to know how to overcome some of the symptoms that may not be so comfortable in our lives. I'm sorry? Oh. Okay. I thought someone was asking the question there. Okay. All right. So then we just want to be able to use some natural remedies to help to overcome some of these illnesses, some of the symptoms that we experience, just to make ourselves more comfortable, especially during the season. The cold flu season that is pretty here. Some people are already getting sick, and you need to know what to do to help to kick it right, nip it right in the butt. Just drink a little bit of water here. A little bit of dry fruit. I've been talking a lot today in a health session there, and we have devotions twice a day and different stuff there, so my voice is going on all day. So then, one of the things that you can do as it pertains to viral infections, and most of them would be helped the same way. So if you have, like, let's say the cold, the flu, influenza, whatever strain of the influenza, COVID-19, any of bronchitis or any of these different issues, the remedies that I'm about to share with you goes across the board to these different viral infections that you will get. So then one way that viruses tend to, you will inhale the viruses, you know, most often goes up the nasal passageway. And one of the things that you can do if somebody, like, let's say, has it's sneezing or something, and you're afraid that you're going to catch the thing because you're in the room and whatever, and the virus is spread and you can inhale it into your nasal passageway, especially the COVID-19, it starts to build up, you know, in your nasal cavity. And what you can do, you can probably do like a neti pot, if any of you've seen a neti pot before. Also, not just only a neti pot, but you can get like a bottle and put a hole into the cover of a plastic bottle, like a 16-ounce plastic bottle. And what you would do is, like, you can put a teaspoon of salt in about 1 cup of water, and you can boil it for a little while, probably like 5-10 minutes, just to sterilize that water a little bit, make sure that there is nothing, the bacteria from your water, whatever you're using. You can use pure
We're not hearing you.
We're not hearing you, Renoir.
We're not hearing you.
He's not hearing us neither. Somebody put it in the chat. Not hearing you.
Texting.
We're
not hearing you.
We're not hearing you, Renoir.
Okay. Yes. So then let me just share my screen here really quick.
We're hearing you now.
Okay. Okay. Okay, the phone is not, you're not hearing me good in the phone?
Are you hearing us? Are you hearing us?
Okay. Do I have to show some of the stuff here in the video? Is it cutting out a lot, or is it just at one time?
At one time.
Okay, let's see how we continues to go. Because I just wanted to show some of the stuff out there on the table, you know, just so you can see. So then you just run. So with the nasal passageway, you would put like a teaspoon of salt into a cup of water, and then you can boil it for like 5 to 10 minutes. And then you can just make sure all that salt is dissolved, and you can use that saline water, that salt water, to a neti pot. So you can get a neti pot at a pharmacy or any like drugstore, or you can use a bottle, put a hole into the cap, and you can run that through your nasal passageway. So what you're doing is getting rid of that virus before it starts to build up and form. So I don't know if you know much about the COVID-19. One, like let's say 3 days, the virus is building up in the nasal cavity, the nasal passageway here, and then it starts to go down and spread lower into your throat. And then it starts to build up in the throat here. That's why you get the scratchy throat and sore throat and stuff like that. So then you want to do that to help to, you know, get rid of it from your nasal passageway before it goes deeper. You can even put like a drop of tea tree oil in there as well, because that is antibacterial, antiviral as well. And you can help to wash that nose, that nasal cavity. So then now when the virus goes down lower, you start to feel sore throat. One of the things that you can do for sore throat, you can actually take oregano oil, or olive oregano, some people call it olive oregano, and you can take that olive oregano, and sometimes I like to do it straight. I would put like one or two drops like on my tongue and just swallow, and then, you know, it's a little strong, the oil is strong and potent, So then if you don't like the strong taste of the olive,
not hearing you anymore. Somebody pray. Not hearing you, sir. Renwa, I don't think we're hearing you.
Important to do as well. So now, what do you do now when that virus, you know, starts to go lower down into your respiratory tract, and then you have mucus that is building up and you're coughing up mucus and so forth? So then what you can do here is use the onion. So the onion, you can make a cough syrup and you're beginning to cough. Just the other day, like if something was trying to, you know, to catch a virus, was trying to spread in my system, my respiratory tract. And then all I did, I just take the oil of oregano. I put a few drops on my tongue, maybe like twice a day. The next day, like twice the next day. And, you know, it never formed, never went down. Nothing happened. I just feel a little sore throat, and then it just went away. I didn't have nothing much going on with me. So then if it goes deeper down your respiratory tract and you start coughing the mucus and stuff like that, you need to make like a cough syrup, a cough remedy. So this is what you can do for a cough remedy as well. So you take the onion, you can chop it up, you can dice it, and then you would take like a jar, and you would seal that jar up with the onion, the whole onion, put it in the jar. And you can take those ball jars. You know, we like buying those ball jars. You can get it. We've even gotten it at hardware stores as well. At the Walmart, we got it. So probably hardware stores and even online, you can buy those ball jars if you don't have any other glass jars. It's just good to have glass jars around. So then you can chop up the onion, put it inside of there, like dice it up, put it inside of there, and you can take some honey. And you fill up the honey above where the onion, where you can see the onion in the jar. So it's a little higher than the onion. And what you do, you can cover it and you can just leave it out in the counter, like in a dark place or whatever, cool dark place. And then you would come by every day and you'll just shake it up. So you shake it up so it doesn't spoil. You can start taking, six scoops of the honey and so forth, the onion syrup immediately, but you just keep shaking it and leaving it there to sit for a few days. And that it gets more potent and more potent as the days go on and as the sits inside of the honey. So then that's how you would, what you would do for cough syrup. Also, you know, onion is also expectorant. So expectorant means that it helps to bring up or expel mucus from the respiratory tract. And not only can you do it by making the onion syrup, but also you can just chop the onion and you can even scrape up the onion and get the juices flowing. And you can put it by your bedside, right in your room. And then what you would see is your nose will even continue running while the onion is sitting there in your room, just like half of your onion or two halves of the onion, and just sitting there in your room. And you're breathing that in throughout the night. That helps to just thin out your mucus and bring up your mucus, what we call expectorant, expel the mucus from your system. So that's something else that you can do. Just chop up the onion, scrape it up, get the juices flowing, and then you just leave it by your bedside where you're sleeping. You're going to smell onion in the room, but that's okay. It's better than having, you know, that cough, persistent cough and so forth. So that's something that you can do for cough hair. Also, what you want to do as well, you can make like a cough syrup. So let me give you a recipe here that you can use. And what you can do here, you can write this one down. Just going to sign this one here. Okay, so what you will do here, so some of the ingredients that would be included in this cough syrup is the onion, we have the garlic, you're gonna have honey in there, some peppermint oil. And the thing about garlic here, garlic have something called allicin in there. And allicin, what it does, it helps to kill viruses. It's antibacterial, antiviral, antifungal, and it's just like so many just antimicrobial. So it just helps to kill viruses, bacteria, fungus, and all those various things. And you know, a lot of times people take antibiotics. And you know, the thing is about antibiotics, they kill, you know, bacteria, meant to kill bacteria. And then sometimes you have like a virus that you want to kill, and you have a virus inside of you, and sometimes the antibiotic wouldn't help. So then this is something that you can do, and it just helps killing all different types of the intruders that comes into your body. So that's garlic, very potent, and also onion, these two are very potent, antibacterial, antiviral, and so forth. So then what you do is 1 cup of honey, and then you do 1/2 cup of chopped garlic, 1/2 cup of chopped onion, and we'll have a juice of 2 lemons. So you do 2 lemons there, and 1/2 teaspoon of cayenne pepper, 1/2 teaspoon of cayenne pepper, 1/3 teaspoon of peppermint oil. And then to make it even more potent, you can do like a quarter cup of horseradish juice. That is going to be very potent. 1/4 cup of horseradish juice there. And if you can do that here, you know, the horseradish is very powerful. It's very hard to find, but if you can find it, you know, you need to pick it up, because we used to have it some at our local grocery stores around, but it's very hard, difficult to find a horseradish nowadays, especially where we live. So if you can find it in your local grocery stores close by, then that would be great. So 1 cup of honey, 1/2 cup of chopped garlic, 1/2 cup of chopped onion, a juice of 2 lemons, 1/2 teaspoon of cayenne pepper, 1/3 teaspoon of peppermint oil, 1/4 cup of horseradish juice. You can just run that through a juicer, or you can blend it and then squeeze it out, like with a cheesecloth, or strain it or whatever, and squeeze out the juice. So whatever way that you choose to do that, to liquefy that can help her. So that's very potent. So you blend all these ingredients together, and then you take 1/2 teaspoon as needed. So you blend all of them together, and you take like 1/2 teaspoon or even 1 teaspoon as needed. So you can take that when you're coughing, you just take 1 teaspoon of that, and that's going to help to knock out your cough. Not only is it going to help to knock out your cough, but you have the stuff in there that is antibacterial, antifungal, antiviral, and that's going to help to kill the virus as well. So your body, your neutrophils, your white blood cells is going in, and it's killing the virus. But you want to aid the body in killing the virus as well. So then these are some things that you can do to help to kill that virus as well. Another major thing that we'll end off with the viral infections, one thing that you can do is steam inhalation. So then you'll take like menthol crystals. So if you think about peppermint, eucalyptus oil, those things have menthol inside of there. And menthol is the ingredient that is expectorant and thins out your mucus. So if you can get the menthol crystals direct, it's even more potent. You'll put that inside of a humidifier, and you can have the menthol crystals, like just a little bit, like, you know, just a pinch of the menthol crystals, and just drop it inside the humidifier, because it's very strong and potent. And you have that, your humidifier going on throughout the night while you sleep, and your nose will just keep running, because you're breathing in the menthol crystals, it's thinning out the mucus, and it's draining out of your system. So you're draining out essentially the viruses and the bacteria, draining out as much as you can from your your respiratory tract. So that's one of the remedies that is easy to do and very powerful as well. So let's change gears here a little bit. One of the things that we dealt with throughout our session here as well, we had someone who came in with ulcer, and they have painful pain when they eat when they eat food and so forth, but especially when they're stressed. And oftentimes you can have like gastritis, you can have an ulcer, different digestive issues that is giving you pain in your digestive area. So one of the things that you can do to help with inflammation internally, that is by using this this cabbage. So cabbage. And we juice the cabbage. So what you would do to juice this cabbage here, obviously you need a juicer. And then you just chop this up into like, to make it quicker for me, I chop it up into like cubes kind of, like long rectangular shapes that can fit inside of the juicer. And we juice the cabbage. So then one of the remedies that you can use here for the cabbage recipe, I'll do both cabbage and also not just cabbage only, but potato as well. So then you can take this recipe down, and what you would do when you apply this recipe, you'd probably want to stop eating for a few days. So then you can stop eating for 2 to 3 days, and then that's going to help you here with healing your stomach. So you stop the stomach from working, you give your stomach a break, and then you can take this juice recipe here, and you can drink that 4 times a day, and then that will help you to heal your ulcers and different issues that you have with your digestion. So you can juice for like 3 days, you know, going on to 5 days or 7 days if you want to. The longer the better, obviously. So then what you do, you use 6 ounces of cabbage, and then you would do 4 ounces of potato. Potato is also anti-inflammatory, so it helps with inflammation, especially when you have like sores inside of your body. So 6 ounces of cabbage, 4 ounces of potato, and then you can do also, so that's 10 ounces here. And then you do about 4 ounces of carrot juice, and then 2 ounces of beet juice. So 4 ounces of carrot juice and 2 ounces of beet juice. Now, you know, carrot is good too with nutrition. Beets help the blood and helps to lower blood pressure and so many various things there. But also beets is sweet as well. So then the cabbage doesn't have the most pleasant taste. So then the carrots and the beets will help the taste to cancel out the taste of the cabbage and the potato, because cabbage has a strong taste. So just to let you know, it does have a strong taste. So then you would make this there. This is 16 ounces in all. So 6 ounces of cabbage, 4 ounces of potato, 4 ounces of carrots, and 2 ounces of beets. And then you would make a juice out of that. You mix the juice all together, and you drink that 4 times a day. So you can separate that in the day however you want to, but a schedule that we use at our lifestyle center with all our guests, we have them drink juice at 8 o'clock, then we have another one at 11 o'clock, then we have another one at 2 o'clock, and then we have another one at 4 o'clock. So that's kind of like our schedule of how we break down the juices that we give our guests at the center. So 8 o'clock, 11, 2 o'clock, and 4 o'clock. So that's just an idea of how you can schedule out your juices throughout the day. And what you can do as well is to juice in the morning, and you can juice for the whole day. Sometimes you can even juice up to 2 days. The better the juicer, the longer you can keep your juice in the fridge. So then the juicer that we love right now, and it's accessible to a lot of people, is the Nama juicer. I don't know if you ever heard of the Nama juicer, N-A-M-A. It's a little more on the pricey end. You can get a discount. You can get it for like $493 in after tax, $570, $520, somewhere around that range. And the juicer, that's a pretty good juicer here. And it's cold press juicer as well. So with cold press juicer, how it works, you know, it's cold presses the juice. It has minimal heat applied when it's extracting the juice. So then it doesn't denature the juice as much, and it can last longer in the fridge because it's not, heat hasn't been applied and so forth. So then it's more potent. So, you know, you just get a juicer, and you can juice for like 2 days in advance, especially the good juicers. Even up to 3 days, after 3 days, I don't use the juice anymore. We don't keep juice for longer than 3 days because then the nutrients just goes down and down more afterwards. So you want to have the most potent as possible. So you can just juice in advance, and then you drink that throughout the day, as I mentioned, the four times throughout the day, and that can help you heal your different ulcers and different digestive issues that you may have. Now, just feel free, you know, in the chat, if you have any questions about anything that I'm asking, explaining so far, just feel free to ask any questions, because I know that our time is, you know, it's going to be up soon. And also with cabbage as well, not only can you use it for inflammation internally inside the body, but you can use cabbage for inflammation outside of the body as well. So you can take like the cabbage leaf here. You can take the cabbage leaf, and with the cabbage leaf, as I said before, it's anti-inflammatory. And what you would do, you can take the leaf and you can beat the leaf. You can take something here and just, you know, pound it on the table. Just pound the leaf with something, whatever you can find. And just pound it here. And then you would kind of see like, probably you can't see this in the camera here, but you can see like the juices flowing, you know, on the cabbage here. And then you just want the juices to flow. So you beat the cabbage up, get the juices flowing. And then that's exactly what they're going to be doing. I'm talking about arthritis pain. Somebody just asked, what can you do for arthritis pain? That's exactly what we're showing right now. So the cabbage, you beat it, and you can take that. And if you have, like, let's say, inflammation in your knee area, you apply this over your knee. You take saran wrap or plastic wrap. You know, the saran is a brand, the plastic wrap. And then you wrap that around your knee. You just wrap the plastic wrap, wrap it all around your knee. And you can just tear the plastic wrap. And usually that plastic wrap will stay in place. But you can also use like a tape. You can just tape it on at the ends, so that way it stays on your knee. And you leave this on. Obviously, I have my pants on. You're not going to put it on your pants, directly on the skin. And then you leave this on for at least 6 to 8 hours or overnight. So it's best you can apply it before you go to bed and leave it on until you wake up in the morning. And then you take it off in the morning. So not only can you apply this on your knees, you can apply it on your ankles. You can apply this on even edema. If you have like swelling of water retention anywhere in your body, you can apply that over that. It can help to draw out the water from the area that is being inflamed and causing that water retention. You can apply it in your elbows, in your back, you know, just use more leaves. So if you have a wider area to cover, use more leaves, or use less leaves if you don't have a big area to cover. So this is great. It works for inflammation. And we have many people in the past who've used this, and it helps the inflammation in such a tremendous way. We've had people like a pastor in Queens who tried it, and he went home, he tried it on his back, and he applied it for two or three days, and he said after the second day he felt, he's like, wait a minute, I don't feel any pain in my back anymore. And you know, it has helped him to with his back area. We had another guest who were here who was having some swelling in her arms, and she said ever since she got like the COVID vaccine, she was having like water retention in that one side of her arm. And so we applied the cabbage leaves on the swelling in her arm, and then her arm went down after applying the cabbage leaves. So then, you know, cabbage leaves works wonders for edema, water retention, for inflammation, for arthritis, any arthritic pain. It's just an anti-inflammatory remedy that you can use to help to overcome, you know, different pain and different ailments, itises in different areas of our body. So both internally and externally as well. And so any questions? I know our time is kind of running down. Before I talk about anything again, I just want to see if there's any questions. Anybody have any more questions as well? So that we can make sure that we address any questions that you have this evening. Yes. Okay, Ebola syndrome. Yep, so then the thin cabbage, you can use that thin cabbage as well. Depends on how bad the irritable bowel syndrome is. You want to make sure that you can take some charcoal. So if somebody's like having like diarrhea and stuff like that, charcoal is a great remedy for diarrhea. Like you can take the charcoal and the diarrhea stops like almost immediately. So it helps to thicken up the stool, and so that it doesn't come out like in a diarrhea form. So, you know, taking that cabbage juice, the cabbage remedy, digestive support juice, that can help. Because also cabbage, when it goes into the digestive system, is what we call like a prebiotic. So it goes into our large intestines. When it sits in our large intestines for a few hours, it begins to ferment, and that can help to promote the good bacteria in our gut, which can, you know, the bad bacteria overtaking our gut can cause like irritable bowel syndrome and irritability in our bowels, so to speak. And also another thing that you can do is just taking a vegan probiotic. You're gonna make sure that you take a vegan probiotic. A lot of people have issues, you know, especially after taking antibiotics. And some people take a lot of antibiotics and it kills the gut, the good bacteria in the gut. And that can cause bad bacteria to overgrow and cause a bunch of different digestive ailments, you know, in our gut. So you just want to make sure that you build up your good, you know, gut flora, your good bacteria in your gut. You can take a colon cleanser as well. Make sure that you cleanse out your colon to take out any waste that might be sitting there stagnated in your colon. Take a colon cleanser, then do the juices and rebuild after you take the colon cleanser with a good probiotic and even with the juices that can help to build up some of your bacteria, good bacteria as well in your gut. And for the, as I said, the diarrhea, you can take like a charcoal that can help to stop any diarrhea like bowels that somebody's having with digestive issues as well. So that's just a little synopsis, quick thing that you can do. Obviously there is more, but it will take some time to go over everything that you can do as well. And you want to make sure that you stay from dairy. Dairy is a big one. Stay away from dairy. Obviously, you know, you just want to go on a plant-based diet. That's the most healthiest to sustain health and for all different types of illnesses and ailments. A plant-based diet is powerful. Any other questions? Yes. Yes. You can go ahead. You can continue. Okay, so I answered that just a while ago with the cabbage. So you can use the cabbage to apply on the area that have the pain. Cabbage is anti-inflammatory, so it helps to absorb some of that inflammation in like with arthritis and so forth. So the cabbage remedy, that's what it's for. It's for the arthritis. Another thing that you can do if you want something more to do as well, there is a supplement, you know, turmeric is very good as an anti-inflammatory. But the compound that I found that is, you know, in the turmeric, the phytochemical that is powerful is the curcumin. And you can take the curcumin, the extract. So you can go online and look for a curcumin capsule or tablet and so forth. You want to make sure that you look for some that has some sort of, like, let's say, like black pepper inside of it that can help the absorption of the curcumin. Or you can even, you know, get something like fats. Some of them have fats. You don't look for plant-based fat as well. Some of them come with coconut oil or whatever. They use different fat mixture. So it can be fat soluble as well. It can help to absorb the turmeric a little better, or the black pepper helps to increase its potency by sometimes 10 times by just having that black pepper inside of it. So when you look for your supplement, you're going to look for the thing. You don't need to just take a supplement that's just turmeric only. It may not be as powerful. I mean, it will have some benefits, but it wouldn't be as powerful. So that's something that you can look out for as well to help with arthritic pain, not just arthritic pain, but any type of inflammation in the body. And curcumin is one of those herbs that is powerful for many different things there as well. You know, even show benefits with cancer. It show benefits with, you know, inflammation inside the body as well. So pain inside the body, like different digestive issues, and also outside the body as well. So it has many different use cases. Yes. So one thing that you want to do when you make anything, you know, by making food for people in a more commercial way, then you have to be cognizant of how long your stuff lasts for. And one of the things that can last, that can make something spoil quicker, is the jars or whatever that you're using is contaminated. So you want to make sure that you use a glass jar, and then you can make sure you wash that glass jar. So you sanitize it, you wash it before, and then you rinse it out in some hot water. You can even boil water, put it in the hot, like boiling water, pour boiling water in it, and just Let it sit there for a few seconds, like 30 seconds or so, so it can kill any bacteria that is in that jar. And it can last much longer. And then what you want to do, you want to keep it in the fridge so that that can last, you know, in the fridge. What you can leave it outside at first, you know, shake it up every day, keep shaking it every day so it doesn't spoil. And then you put it in the fridge and it can last for a pretty long time because honey lasts for a long time. So what I would say is leave the onion in there for like, let's say about 5 to 7 days. You shake it every day so it doesn't spoil. And then you can even like eventually after like the 5th, 7th day, you can strain out the honey and strain out the onion and separate the onion from the honey. And you just have the honey only and you put that in the fridge. When you have the honey only, so the onion absorbs into the honey, then it can last much longer. So it can last upwards, if you keep it really well, up to a month, just in the fridge. So that's something you can do. So make sure you extract the honey, the onion afterwards, after it extracts into the honey to make it last even longer. So someone asked about bone pain, what you can do for bone pain. So it depends on what bone pain you're talking about. Are you talking about bones rubbing against each other or just bone pain in general? Because what you can do for bone pain in general, make sure you're drinking enough water, stay away from refined sugar. So that's white sugar, brown sugar, any crystallized form of sugar. Usually the process of crystallization takes away a lot of nutrients from the sugar. So it's just like glucose and you don't have any nutrients, nutritive value. It's just like an empty caloric food. And what happens with that? Your body to digest food, your body needs other minerals and vitamins that should be present. So to assimilate, to create energy, your body needs minerals and vitamins. So when you don't have calcium present in that food itself, your body says, hey, you know what? Let me learn it from the bones. Let me learn it from the teeth and to make that, to metabolize sugar and so forth. So you want to make sure that you stay away from those refined sugars. You can use more nutritious sweeteners like honey and agave and even molasses. Those things are more nutritive. And also, you want to drink enough water so you're, you know, that you can help if it's your ligaments or your synovial fluid or so forth. Dehydration can cause pain in the like rubbing of the bones together. And also, you want to make sure you have to walk, exercise every day. Exercise helps to strengthen the bones. So that's one of the best things that you can do to keep your bones strengthened, especially as you get older. You lose bone mass as you get older. So you can slow down your loss of bone mass by exercising, walking every single day. It's very powerful, very simple, but very powerful as well. So these are some simple things that you can do just to help with bone pain. And obviously you can take the curcumin as well to help with that pain. If you feel in pain, it's anti-inflammatory to help with that pain, but do the other stuff to, you know, help your problem that you're experiencing. And also you want to make sure that you substitute your dairy for more plant-based dairy, because with dairy is very acid forming. So then when it creates that acid state in your bloodstream, you know, if you go down, if your bloodstream becomes too acidic, then what happens? Your body is like, hey, let's bring it back to the right pH levels. So then how your body does that to neutralize the acid, it will draw calcium. So calcium is drawn from your bones and your teeth and so forth to neutralize the acid state that is in your bloodstream. So then by eliminating dairy from your diet, then you can eat more alkaline forming foods that is closer to our body's pH. So then you can have your plant-based foods. Basically, those things are more on the body's pH realm. So then that can help you to maintain a good pH in your body. I mean, you know, your body cannot become too acidic. People always say, you know, your body's in an acid state or whatever. It can take a lot for your body to become in an acid state because your body maintains homeostasis. Your body always tries to maintain balance. However, you can put a strain in your body by constantly trying to bring your equilibrium back to the right pH, and that can help, that can deteriorate your bones over time. So just substitute your dairy, your acid-forming foods, sugar, very acid-forming food as well, caffeine, acid-forming foods. So those things you want to eliminate from your diet and just substitute those for plant-based milks, natural sweeteners, staying away from caffeine. Make sure you're getting your rest on time so you don't lack that energy that you need by drinking coffee or sodas or black tea or any of those teas that have caffeine in there. So you want to stay away from those things to make sure that your bones are as strong as possible. And then probably the last remedy here, and then we can probably close off here. Someone asked suggestions for asthma. So one of the things that you can do is you can use that cough syrup remedy that I gave you. You can help to break up any mucus that may cause any blockage in the respiratory tract. But also you can get the onion here. If someone is getting an asthma attack, you can cut up the onion in half, and then you can scrape that onion. Scrape it with a fork or something, or knife. You can scrape it, make lines in it, get the juices flowing, and then it will smell very strong, but you inhale that. You inhale the half of the onion, and you just keep inhaling that, and that can help to calm your respiratory tract, clean out the mucus and so forth, so your lungs don't close on you. And then that can help with asthma attack. You can even take the other half of the onion, rub it in your chest. Eventually, it will penetrate in your skin, and it can be absorbed into your respiratory tract area here as you rub on your chest. So you keep inhaling, take deep breaths into the onion, and you rub it on your chest as well. That can help with asthma attack. And one thing that you can do as well to help to calm down your respiratory tract, we have an antispasmodic herb. It's called lobelia. And we do have tinctures there. If you can get a tincture, even better, more potent, you can just grab it and use it immediately. So you can take the lobelia tincture. Take like a drop of full, if you get in tincture form, a drop or two drop of full, and it's antispasmodic, so it helps to calm your respiratory tract. And you can overdose on lobelia as well. If you take too much, then it can do the opposite effect where it brings up the mucus. So if you want to like bring up mucus in, you know, like for asthma, you bring up the mucus, then you can take those the droppers full as well. And just herbs that you can use to bring up mucus from your respiratory tract. You can use mullein, slippery elm. All the herbs are like mucilaginous. It helps to form new mucus and also bring up the mucus, expectorant, so forth. Those herbs are good for respiratory tract as well. And the biggest thing for asthma, you need to stop what's forming a lot of mucus in your respiratory tract. And as we said about dairy being acid forming, dairy is also mucus forming as well. Dairy can cause a lot of mucus to build up in your system because, you know, they pasteurize the milk, but there's still some bacteria that you drink in the milk, and that can cause your body to react and build up mucus inside your respiratory tract. So then with children, when they're young and they have asthma, the first thing that we tell them to give up is just give up the dairy. And oftentimes just by doing that one thing, that can help to resolve the asthma issue. So making sure that you just no more dairy, you know, if you don't want the asthma, that is, if you want your asthma, you can continue the dairy. But if you don't want it, then no more dairy. And then doing those remedies just to help your lungs to bring up mucus and to help to thin out the mucus and clean out your lungs and so forth. And any of the respiratory remedies that I gave prior, you can use those respiratory remedies that can help to help your asthma. Any respiratory problems? Should I end right now, or do we have room for one more question?
Yes, you can take a question.
Somebody said, can I repeat the garlic recipe? Is that for the cough syrup you're talking about?
Yes, the cough syrup. Thank you.
Okay. All right. So then this is what we can do here.
Yes.
Give you this here again. So that way you can have this. It's good for the season two as well that we're in. So you'll do 1 cup of honey, 1/2 cup of chopped garlic, 1/2 cup chopped onion, juice 2 lemons, and 1/2 teaspoon cayenne pepper, 1/3 teaspoon of peppermint oil, and 1/4 cup of horseradish. If you kind of find a horseradish, that's okay. Do without a horseradish, because I know it's a little more difficult to find in some of our stores around. So Let's repeat one more time just to make sure that we have it. 1 cup honey, 1/2 cup chopped garlic. Sorry, 1/2 cup chopped onion, 2 lemons, 1/2 teaspoon of cayenne pepper, 1/3 teaspoon of peppermint oil, and 1/4 cup of horseradish. This is the remedy that you can do, you know, cough syrup. Not just, it's just on a, we call it the cough syrup, but it has garlic, onion in there. Those are antibacterial, anti, you know, viral. So this thing can fight the virus at the same time, while it helps to bring up the mucus. And also it helps to soothe your throat, especially when you cough a lot and it becomes irritable and it becomes dry. The honey helps to coat the throat to help to just relax you from keep coughing all the time and so forth.
Okay, that's it, Brother St. Juste?
I believe so. We said a lot. We have a lot more that we can share, but you know.
That's enough for tonight, right? Well, folks, if you really appreciate these 4 sessions that the St. Juste brothers bring, I just want you to put an A in the chat, A, that you appreciate it. And I want to ask Renoir to take back the thank you to Ezra and Monet. We are glad to have you all. And we are thankful for what God has been doing through you. We pray that the Lord will bless you as you continue bringing health and healing to the others. So you take very good care of yourself. And I know you know the folks at Goshen and the folks in the Healing of the Nations. So we just want to say thank you very much. And you're always welcome, Matt. You know, whenever you want to come, just let us know. We don't have to invite you. Just let us know, Pastor. The Lord give me something special, and I want to share with the people. All right?
It's our pleasure.
How's everybody doing? How's everybody doing? Huh? I didn't hear that. All right.
I say it's our pleasure.
All right. Great. God bless you. I know, folks, for those of you who want to see any of the program that you've missed, for those that you could go on Goshen YouTube program and look for the Wednesday night. We did battling beating diabetes. We did easing depression naturally. There's we did the answer to cancer money. Last week. And now we did natural remedies. So you can go to Goshen YouTube channel. Or if you want to go on Facebook, you could go to Healing Up the Nation Facebook channel. And I want you to not only take this for yourself, but you have non-Adventist friends and families that you can share them with. A lot of people need these natural remedies to help them in times like these. I want you to prepare yourself. It's very important that you prepare yourself. I have a few more announcements that we just want to share and go now. Remember tomorrow morning, we're having, if you really want to feel revived and refreshed, tomorrow morning and every morning for the rest of this month and next month from 6 to 7, except on Sabbath, we have Revive Us, O Lord. It's a real refreshing, renewing, challenging program, bringing us back to some of the things that we learned that we have missed. And praise God for those who are coming. So only if you want to be revived, refreshed, and reformed, you can come tomorrow morning at 6 o'clock, right? Then we want to...
I want you to make sure you look in your email or in your text, because this coming Sunday evening, we have an in-house revelation.
Good evening, good night, and good afternoon, everyone, again. And thank you for staying with us. I know that many of you were blessed. I can see the A, a lot of A going on there. And so thank you again for joining us. I see Sister Favorite has her hand up. I'm going to unmute you, Sister Favorite. Go ahead.
Yes. Hi, Brother Lincoln. Hi, Brother Courtney. I just had a quick question.
I'm not hearing you.
Oh, I was saying, I just had a quick question.
All right, so I'm going to finish up with a prayer. I hope that you were blessed. Thank you for joining us on the Wednesday night service. Wow. My name is Courtney Linton, and please join us. We have different times that we have the different services. And so thank you again for joining us. Let's say a short prayer. Loving God and our Father, as you heard the message that we must not just change the small things, but change the big things also, Heavenly Father. And so, Father, we thank you for the change that we will make. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. And so thank you all for coming. I'm going to close out with my favorite theme song, and so I will see you again. Thanks again for joining us.